This is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. Good morning, Mom Mariah and friends. Thank you so much for joining into our online worship experience on this morning. I tell you, we have a treat for you on this morning. In our worship experience, we have the dynamic LaToya Adams, who's a mezzo-soprano. She's going to render a selection for us on this morning. We also have great music accompaniment by our very own Mom Mariah Musical Department. Our sermon this morning is entitled, We Serve a Great God Who Can Do Big Things. During these challenging times, we have to remember that we serve a great God who can do awesome things despite what we might be going through. So join in with our choir as they lead us by way of song.
Thank you.
teaching moment, I have a couple of announcements. Next Sunday is Annual Youth Day, Young Adult Day. And we have a dynamic guest speaker lined up for worship service on next Sunday. And Miss Mary Smith is spearheading our Baptist School Bash. And she will be collecting a special offering during our third Sunday worship. So come prepared third Sunday of this month to give an offering for our Baptist School Bash. And next week is our summer revival. It's gonna be July the 15th through the 17th, that Monday through the Wednesday. And we're gonna have three dynamic preachers, Reverend Bolton out of Camden, Reverend Laston of the Laston Chapel Baptist Church, and Reverend Malcolm Taylor from New Life Buelow Baptist Church will be with us. Amen. And to add a special twist to our revival, we're going to have financial planning and wealth building seminars each night starting at 6 p.m. Amen. 1 hour prior to the service. Amen. Because we can't ask you to tithe if we don't have good money management skills. Amen. 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 We want you all to do well out there as well as in here. Amen. Amen. And we'd like to acknowledge our guest, Mr. and Mrs. Richard Jackson. So good to have you all here with us today. And to Michelle Goodwin, and Zion and Dr. Church, thank you so much for being with us today. And to Ms. Barbara Hunter, thank you so much. We're glad to have you back in worship with us. Amen. We're going to continue to keep you in our prayers, you and your entire family as well. Let us pray. Spirit of the living God, we acknowledge your presence in this place. We thank you, God, for how you moved mightily thus far in this worship service through the song ministry. Now at this time of preachment, O God, we ask that you move with power and you move with might. We ask that you meet us at our individual points of need. It is our prayer that this preached word point us back towards you and your saving cross. Lord God, it's our prayer that this word lift up some bowed head, comfort some weeping heart. Lord God, do what you do best. Heal, set free, deliver, restore, and redeem. And if you do these things, oh God, we'll forever give your name the glory. We'll forever give your name the honor. And we'll forever give your name the praise. It's in your Son, Jesus' name, that we pray and we give thanks. Let all of God's people say, amen. The scripture for this morning's worship experience is 2 Kings, the 4th chapter. Verses 1 through 7. 2 Kings, the 4th chapter, verses 1 through 7. And it reads, now the wife of a member of the company of prophets cried to Elijah, saying, your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that your servant feared the Lord. But a creditor has come to take my two children as his slaves. Elijah said to her, what shall I do for you? Tell me, what do you have in your house? She answered, your servant has nothing in the house except for a jar of oil. He said, go outside, borrow vessels from all of your neighbors and empty vessels, and not just a little bit of them, but get a lot. Then go in and shut the door behind you and your children and start pouring into these vessels.
when each is full, set it aside. So she left him and shut the door behind her and her children. They kept bringing vessels to her, and she kept pouring. When the vessels were full, she said to her son, bring another vessel. But he said to her, there are none, no more. Then the oil stopped flowing. She came and told the man of God, Elijah, and said, and he said to her, go sell the oil and pay your debt, and you and your children can live off of the rest. We would like to use for a sermonic title, a great God who can do big things. A great God who can do big things. This morning, I'm coming to make a public service announcement to announce that we serve a big God, a great God, who can do big, awesome, mighty, and miraculous things. With God, there is no failure. With God, every round goes higher and higher. With God, there is increase and not decrease. There is promotion and not demotion. With God, there is always progression and not regression. With God, every generation should do better than the previous generation. For the Bible says, one generation shall praise thy works to another and shall declare thy mighty acts. In other words, one generation will say, God has been good to me. And the next generation will say, he's been even better to us. One generation shall declare to the next generation that God has been good. I come to tell somebody that if you think what God has done has been good, just wait and see what God is going to do. Elijah believed and expected God to do bigger, greater, and better in his life. Yes, God has been good to his spiritual father, Elijah. But Elijah saw what God had done through Elijah, the many miracles such as he stopped it from raining for 3 years. He saw Elijah bring back the rain. He saw Elijah call fire to fall from heaven. He even wished Elijah part the Jordan River. Elijah saw all that God did through his spiritual father, Elijah. So he said that if God did that for him, I know that God can do that and more for me. Elijah had the unmitigated gall, and he said, God, I want a double portion of what you did for Elijah. Elijah said to Elijah, if you see me when I'm taken up into heaven, then you will get what you asked for. Even though Elisha honored and respected his spiritual father, Elijah, he believed that God had more for him. He wanted a double portion of Elijah's anointing. In other words, he was saying, I want God to do more in my life than he did for my spiritual father. Elijah wanted God to give him a double portion of anointing, a double portion of favor, a double amount of miracles in his life, and double amount of blessings. Elisha, in essence, was saying, I want God to bless me so much that I can take this ministry to another level. Elijah said, I'm not asking so that I can make my name great, but I want it so that I can reveal more of how awesome, how amazing, and how great God is. After he had received a double portion of the anointing, Elijah performed not 8, but 16 miracles. And for you see, Elijah, his spiritual father, only performed 8 miracles according to the Bible. However, Elisha performed 16 miracles in the Bible. Somebody shout, double. He wanted double the anointing. The Bible says, ask and you shall receive. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened. I believe the only reason why Elisha received double portion of Elijah's anointing is because he asked for it. He didn't have a small thinking mentality, but he knew that he served a big God who could do great and awesome and mighty and mind-blowing things. Elijah said, I don't want the ordinary, but I want the extraordinary. He said, God, give me a double portion of Elijah's anointing. Elijah received received a double portion because he believed and he asked for it. What have you asked for God lately? Have you asked God for any big things? Have you asked God to do any mind-blowing things in your life? You serve a big and awesome and mighty and great God who can do great, big and awesome and mighty things in your life, but it's up to you to ask for him to do it in your life. I just believe that we serve a God who can make us all millionaires. I believe that we serve a God who can increase the number of business owners in our community and in our church. I believe we serve a God who can help you pay off your student loan debt. I believe that we serve a God who can help you to eliminate your personal debt. I believe that we serve a God who can make you debt-free one day. I believe we serve a God who can do the impossible. I believe that we serve a God who can grow this church, allow us to be a beacon on a hill. I believe that we serve a God who can do great, mighty, and awesome things in our lives. For the Bible says nothing is impossible with God. And Jesus said it this way, all things are possible to those that what? Believe. You must believe just as Elijah believed for a double portion. Elijah believed double, and he received double of Elijah's anointing. Just as I previously mentioned, Elijah performed 8 miracles, but Elisha asked for a double portion of Elijah's anointing, and he performed 16 miracles as recorded in the Bible. The double, twice as many miracles as Elisha performed. The first miracle that Elisha performed was dividing the Jordan River with his cloak. This was to show that the same God that was with Elijah is now with Elisha. Elijah thereafter healed the water of the spring of Jericho. This was to show that God can meet their natural needs. God, through Elijah, caused water to come to soldiers of the king of Israel in a dry land. This was again to show that God can meet our natural needs. Later in chapter 4, from which our text is located, God, through Elijah, provided a barren woman known as the Shunammite woman with a child. This was not a need, but a want. God, through this, is showing us through Elijah that he can not only can provide our needs, but he can even give us what we want. For the Bible says, and my God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. He says, in the scripture it says, he gives beasts their food, and he dressed the lilies of the field. If God can give the beasts their food and dress the lilies of the field, imagine what God wants to do for you. In our text for this morning's worship experience, the Lord was having us to focus on how the woman with the issue, or how the woman in our text, the widow woman, went from being needy to living in abundance. She went from being in need in verse 1 to having more than enough by verse 7. This woman and her husband, they loved the Lord. Her husband was a member of the sons of the prophet, meaning that he was a student of the prophet. He, like Elijah, studied and was mentored by Elijah. However, Elijah had enough boldness and faith to ask from the Lord a ridiculous thing, a double portion of Elijah's anointing. This man, on the other hand, died a poor man and left his wife and children broke, busted, and disgusted. This serves as a reminder that just because you see people in church and they're looking good on Sunday morning doesn't mean that they have it all together. Just because they're in leadership doesn't mean that they have it all together. We all have our shortcomings. My shortcoming may not be your shortcoming. Your shortcoming may not be my shortcoming. But we all have our shortcomings. And we all have room for improvement. This woman and her husband were faithful members of the prophet's inner circle, but their finances were still jacked up. They loved the Lord, but they had no money. If the truth is told, many people come to church in their Sunday best, get their praise on Sunday, and then go back home to a jacked up situation. They go back home and then have to face reality. Some have jacked up finances, jacked up marriages, jacked up relationships, jacked up self-esteem. However, the Lord sent me here this declare that it doesn't matter how long you've been in that jacked up situation. It doesn't matter how long you've been in that jacked up financial situation. It doesn't matter how long you've been in that jacked up relationship. It doesn't matter how long you've been you had a jacked up self-esteem. He can turn that situation around and make it better. Just activated with the issue of blood. She struggled for 12 long years, but with one touch from the Lord, with a touch of the hem of his garment, that situation was turned around. Just ask Abraham and Sarah. They waited a long time for their promised child named Isaac, but with time and patience, God fulfilled his promise. Just ask Joshua. It took them 40 years to get to the promised land, but God eventually worked it out. No matter how long you've been dealing with that thing that you're dealing with, God can turn that situation around and cause it to work out for your good. Notice that I said it can. Not that it will. Get better. I said it can get better. The word can implies there's a possibility or that you may have the ability or power for your situation to change, but whether or not it changes often times depend upon what you do. What I do. In the sermon this morning, we will highlight what the widow lady did to improve her situation in the here and the now. She made the proper connection by through prayer, and then she believed, and then she worked her faith. The widow woman cried out to Elijah and said, "Your servant, my husband, is dead. We are in debt. We have been faithful to the Lord, but now a debtor will take my children for payment if we don't pay him because we owe him. Rather than criticizing why they are in debt or looking down our noses at them, let us focus our attention first on what this widow woman did. She took her promise to the Lord. She didn't take her problems to Facebook. She didn't call her brothers or her sisters. She didn't call her friend and talk about how bad her situation was, but she took her problems to the Lord. In those days, the people believed that the power of God rested so mightily among the prophet that they thought when they were talking to Elijah or Elisha, it was like talking to God. When they needed to hear from God, they sent word to the prophet so that they could hear from God. Before going to battle, they oftentimes they asked the prophet what the Lord had to say about this upcoming battle. Likewise, this lady in her distress came to the prophet Elijah to seek help from the Lord. When you're going through difficult times, we got to remember to seek help from the Lord. The best position to be in when you're going through is on your knees. Your knees keep, when you're on your knees, that keeps you humble. When you're on your knees, you're reminded of where your help comes from. When you're on your knees, you're reminded that with much prayer, there is much power. When that husband or wife or that boyfriend or girlfriend start acting strange, pray. When your children give you their backsides to kiss, don't slap them like you want to do, but pray. When you have more bills than money, pray. When you turn on that TV and see children at our southern border and men and women in housed and subhuman conditions, don't fret, but pray. Why? Because prayer changes things. The songwriter wrote in the book of Psalms, "Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he what? Delivered them from their distress, and he made the storm be still, and the waves of the seas were hushed." This widow woman cried to God through Elisha, and he said to her, "Tell me, what do you have in your house?" She said, "I have a small bottle of oil." He replied, "Go borrow some empty vessels. Jesus. Don't just get a few of them, but go get a lot of them." Elijah didn't say, "I will keep you in my thoughts and prayers." No, he helped her to meet her immediate need. If the church is going to be effective in reaching people in the community, we got to meet the immediate need. of people. We've got to address what they are going through in the here and now. If the church is going to reclaim the attention of our young adults and young people, we must meet their immediate need. We must address underemployment. We must address low-wage jobs. We must address gang violence. We must address access to capital for startup businesses. We must address buildings that people face every single day. We must address domestic violence in the home. We must address drug infestation in our community. We got to keep it real and address real needs, real problems that people are going through. God, through Elijah, addressed this woman's real needs. She needed not his prayers, not his thoughts, but she needed money. She needed her debt paid. She needed cash to support her family. So Elijah said, go ask your neighbors for empty bottles. This widow woman could have asked, why do I need empty bottles? What am I going to put in these empty bottles? She could have said, I only have a little bit of oil. Why do I need to get more bottles? However, she obeyed Elijah. Even though she may not have understood how things were going to work out, she obeyed Elijah. Anyways, a lot of times we act like Thomas, the disciple Thomas. We got to see it to believe it. We got to touch it before we believe that it's real. But this woman believed until she saw change in her life. She didn't have to see it to believe it, but she believed so that she could see it. Oh, that went right over your head. She didn't have to see it to believe it, but she believed it so that she could see it. Notice she did not wait until her situation changed to believe, but she believed until her situation changed. Verse 5 said, after Elijah spoke with her, she left him, and she went home and shut the door and began to pour oils in the bottle. She gathered many empty bottles, even though she only had a little bit of oil initially. I imagine she said to herself, I don't know how God is going to work this thing out, but I just believe some way, somehow, God is going to do it. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know how God is going to work it out, but I believe that you believe just like this woman believed. God, some way, somehow, is going to turn that situation around. He's going to restore that relationship. He's going to restore your finances. He's going to help you to accomplish your goals. Some way, somehow, God is going to do it. I imagine she said to herself, I don't know how God is going to work this thing out, but I just believe he is going to do it. When your back is up against the wall, you ought to just trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding, but believe that in all your ways that you acknowledge him, he will direct your path. Not only did she believe what he said, but she expect God to do the ridiculous and give her an abundance of oil. How do I know she believed that? Because the prophet said, go get some empty vessels. Not just a few of them, but a whole lot of them. She believed that not only would God bless her, but he would bless her in abundance. The prophet said to her, get these bottles. And a whole lot of them. She did not hesitate, but she gathered a lot of bottles because she expected God to do some big thing. She expected God to do the miraculous. She expected God to do the impossible. Sometimes you got to step out on faith, and you got to have ridiculous faith. Sometimes you have to put yourself out there because that you look silly. And you say, God, if I'm going to look silly, if I'm going to fall flat on my face, I'm going to fall flat on my face. Trust in you. I'm going to fall flat. She stepped out on faith and did the ridiculous. People probably talked about it. gathering all those empty bottles. And what's she gathering those bottles for? What's she going to put in them? She don't have nothing. Her husband left her broke, and she got all those kids. They had 6, 7, 8, 9 kids. Nobody told them to have all those kids. You know how people talk. They were probably laughing at her. But guess what? When you put your trust, faith, and hope in the Lord, they will have the first laugh. So guess what? You will have the last laugh. If you step out of faith and do the ridiculous, folks may laugh at you on day one. But guess what? You're going to have the last laugh. And God will bless your soul that you will say, it was nobody. And shut the door. I said, why'd you ask her to shut the door? He said, because I want her to know that it wasn't by her power that she got blessed. It wasn't by my power that she got blessed. But it's only by his power, the Lord's power, that she got blessed. Then he said, after she gathered the oil, he said, go sell it to those. Make money. And I imagine when she took people that probably knew her situation. I imagine they probably asked her, where'd you get this oil from? God set that testimony up so that she couldn't say nothing else but it was nobody. Situation may look like, then you will say like Paul, and I'm closing, do not be anxious for anything. Nothing. Don't fret about anything. Nothing. But in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request
We thank God for the reminder that we serve an awesome God, a big God, a mighty God, who can still do great things in our lives during this difficult time that we are experiencing as a nation and as a church. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Father God, we come unto you in your awesome, magnificent, and mighty name of Jesus. We thank you, God, that you are the big God that you are. We thank you, God, that even though we're going through difficult times as a nation, you are yet still in control. You yet still have all power in your hand. Though you sit high, we know that you look down low upon us. You have not forgotten your people. You have not forsaken your people, but you're right here by our side. You're walking with us as we walk through these challenging and difficult times. God, we know that we don't have to worry, nor do we have to fret, because we know that we have a constant friend in you who is with us each and every step of the way. For that, we say thank you, O God. For that, we are grateful, O God. For that, we say we love you, O God. Lord God, we now ask that you continue to bless the leaders of our nation. Continue to enable them to make wise decisions, to guide us in the right direction. Lord, we're not going to fret about how contagious this virus may be, God, but we know that you're going to enable us to follow the instructions of public health officials so that we may keep ourselves as well as our neighbors safe and healthy, oh God. God, now we turn our attention to those who are duty-bound to pray for. God, hold God, your Sumter and family in the palm of your hands. Lord, we lift them before you right now, oh God. We know that grief is a process. Be with them every step of the way of the grief process, Father. You said that you will comfort those who are in mourning. So comfort them right now, oh God. Lord God, also bless the Lawrence family, Anthony Lawrence and family, the family of Sarita Lawrence. Lord God, they are also grieving. God, you said that we call upon you, you will hear us and come to our rescue. God, we are calling upon you. We ask that you wrap your loving arms around your children who are grieving. And Lord God, give them a peace that surpasses all understanding. Lord God, continue to strengthen Mount Moriah. Continue to keep us together by virtual online worship experiences and through our conference prayer, oh God. Continue to enable us to create a sense of community even though we aren't able to come together physically, oh God. Lord, we're expecting you, even through this pandemic, that you still going to get the glory, the honor, and the praise out of this situation some way and somehow. We are believing that you are yet still a great God who can do big things in our lives, oh God. It's in your name we pray and we give thanks. Let all of God's people say amen. There may be somebody who is watching this morning who have yet to accept the Lord, Jesus Christ, as Lord and Savior. If you would like to give your heart unto the Lord and ask God for repentance of your sins, I encourage you to repeat this prayer after me. Father, forgive me of my sins. Cleanse my heart. I make you my Lord and Savior. If you said that prayer this morning, I encourage you to let us know by going to mountmoriahsc.com and completing our data form at the bottom of our website. Or you may email us at mountmoriahsouthcarolina@gmail.com and one of our deacons will get in contact with you. If you would like to give to support the ministry of the Mount Moriah Baptist Church, you can give by going to our website, selecting online giving, and that will connect you with our PayPal account, or you may give through Cash App, and our Cash App name is Mount Moriah SC. We thank you in advance for your contributions. Also, remember, the census is upon us. If you have received your census documentation by mail, I encourage you to complete those forms and send it back in, or you may go online and submit your information electronically. We hope you enjoy this worship experience here at the Mount Moriah Baptist Church, and we hope you join us next Sunday, same time, same place, and remember that you serve a big God who can do great things.